It's a little louder. Okay. We are getting better on our audio, though, as long as I remember to take off my mask and turn on the mic, etc. We got quite a few positive comments from the setup we had last week. And hopefully this week I have the camera pointed at us while I'm speaking. First item on the announcements, search committee update. Russ Trippi, a member of the search committee, circulated via flop notes a survey on behalf of the committee to solicit input from each member of the parish to help the committee in its work. Please take a moment to complete the survey. I have done mine. The information is very important. It shouldn't take too long to fill it out. If you prefer to be called on the telephone, please leave your name, contact number, and the best time to call on the sign-up sheet in the library. It's on the table. You can also do an email to stbartohio@gmail.com. You can telephone call to the church at 440-449-2290, or you can call Cindy Fumick. Her phone number is in the directory. So you've got a lot of different ways of doing it if you don't have access to a computer or just have a phone or something. Please plan to attend the traditional Shrove Tuesday pancake dinner this Tuesday, March 1st, 2022, between 5 and 7 p.m. in the parish hall. The Boy Scout troop is doing, number 124 is doing most of the work. Free will offering will be collected. Father Bob will conduct a service of Holy Eucharist and imposition of ashes Wednesday, March 2nd at 5:30. Please consider starting the season of Lent in prayer with this penitential service. One thing that's unfortunate is we have decided not to hold the fish fries this year. The Boy Scouts thought they could step in to do it for us, but they didn't quite have enough resources. Very few churches in the area are holding fish fries this year, according to Richard. We are going to do a complete evaluation towards a year from now, basically, to see if we can pull it off. Maybe we can adapt our approach so we need fewer people. We'll see what we can do and what our situation is then. Maureen Major, a candidate for ordination, will deliver the sermon next Sunday. Father Bob will officiate that. Our friends at Church of Good Shepherd in Lyndhurst invite us to join them for Lenten study group starting Wednesday, March 2nd. It's based on Bishop Curry's book, The Way of Love in Lent. I have put links on the website, which is up and running now, which will be, you can either go see them in person or you can join them via Zoom. The session will start at 6 p.m. and will run for 7 weeks. Chuck Kay plans to have a funeral service for Norma at St. Bart's on Saturday, June 4th, starting at 10:30. We're working out a lot of details with them. We are still looking for more lectors, so if you are interested in serving as a lector during weekly services, please contact Wendy Charney. And again, please help yourself to one of the beautiful prayer shawls displayed in the library. These shawls are made by loving hands for delivery to those who will find comfort in holding or wearing them while in prayer. The processional hymn is number 129, Christ Upon the Mountain.
Thank you. God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, from now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Psalm 99, starting with refrain and ending with refrain. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God, who is the Holy One. Lord is king. Let the people tremble. He is enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth shake.
The Lord is great in Zion. He is high above all peoples.
Let them confess his name, which is great and awesome. He is the Holy One.
O mighty King, with love and justice, you have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob.
Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God, and fall down before his footstool. He is the Holy One.
O Moses and Aaron among his priests, and Samuel among those who call about his name, they called upon the Lord, and he answered them.
He spoke to them out of the pillar of cloud. They kept his testimonies in the decree that he gave them.
O Lord, our God, we have answered them indeed. You are a God who forgave them, yet have punished us for their evil deeds.
Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God, and worship him upon his holy hill. For the Lord our God is the Holy One.
Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God, who is the Holy One.
Indeed, to this very day, when they hear the reading of the old covenant, that same veil is still there, since only in Christ is it set aside. Indeed, to this very day, whenever Moses is read, a veil is over their minds. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And all of us with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord, as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit. Therefore, since it is by God's mercy that we are engaged in this ministry, we do not lose heart. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we commend ourselves to the conscience of everyone in the sight of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and
appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things they had seen. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Primitive as to confuse fact with fiction, and so venerate and meet up saint before their very real and living God. That would be blasphemy. I explained that we make a grave error when we confuse primitive with ignorant or gullible. I went on to explain that what is so off-putting about St. Margaret to contemporary Western minds is that Western civilization has become so savage as to be unable to accept the beautiful and dramatic and poetic embellishments that attempt to explain what really happened to Margaret during her imprisonment. The struggle of her soul to stand firm in the cross of Christ and not to submit to evil. It is the account of Margaret being swallowed by a dragon that leads to wild speculations by the learned and wise that because some of the images used to describe Margaret's passio are improbable, that all of it is untrue. I mention this because I suspect that your contemporary minds might be very tempted to treat the transfiguration of the Lord, of our Lord, in a way similar to how they had been trained to treat such saints as Margaret of Antioch. Because glorious countenances and effulgent raiment are not within our sphere of common experience, and because Luke is a primitive Christian, it is tempting to dismiss the Transfiguration as a made-up story, a pious parable invented to explain some otherwise elusive religious doctrine. But I want to suggest to you that the gospel lesson you have just heard is exactly what it represents itself to be. An account of what Peter, James, and John witnessed while they were apart and alone with Jesus. And what St. Luke tells us that Peter and John and those who were with him witnessed was the glory of Jesus. Luke attempts to describe this glory by reporting that as Jesus was praying, the appearance of his countenance was altered and his raiment became dazzling white. Now this is a very different thing from what we hear of Moses in the book of Exodus. In that account, we are told that the prolonged exposure of Moses to the presence of God had the effect of causing a kind of celestial sunburn. The prolonged exposure of Moses to the presence of God had the effect of causing the skin of his face to shine. In Hebrew, the word is garam. Translated into Greek, the word would be lampo. But Luke tells us, in the Greek language, Luke tells us that Peter, James, and John beheld the glory, the doxa of Jesus. In other words, while the after effect of being in the presence of God caused the skin of Moses' face to shine, lampo, Jesus manifested God's glory, God's doxa, into his friends. Jesus was and is himself the radiance of the divine glory, the holiness which is the source of truth and life, the holiness which spoke to Moses on Mount Sinai. Who tries to make us understand this by saying that not only was the countenance of Jesus altered, but his garments were dazzling white as well. So, here are Peter, James, and John, who have gone up on a mountain with Jesus, who when he gets there begins to pray. Meanwhile, Peter, James, and John become bored and fall asleep. But something wakes them. And when they open their eyes, they open their eyes to see their friend differently. They open their eyes to see the doxa of Jesus shining with an unearthly brightness. They see the glory of Jesus shining so brightly that it's as if they have died and gone to heaven. The sight frightens Peter, James, and John. But God says to them, "Do not be afraid. This is my son, my chosen." The proper response to his glory is to listen to him. The Greek word Luke uses for listen is akousia, which conveys the sense of accosting Jesus, of capturing him, of receiving the Son. So Luke wants us to understand that the transfiguration of God the Son in the sight of Peter, James, and John, and the word of God the Father spoken from the cloud, are very real things. It's not a made-up story. For just an instant, Luke tells us, for just an instant, the Lord God Almighty gave Peter, James, and John a glimpse of the glorious divinity that is clothed within Christ's mere humanity, so that they too, and all of us, might aspire to the same thing, so that we might appropriate Jesus, so that hearing the gospel with our ears, we might receive Christ's divinity with our lives. It is possible, you know. It is possible for you to accost. It is possible for you to receive Christ's divinity. It is possible because of the incarnation. Because Jesus, whose nature is that of the divine Son, because the divine nature of Jesus is contained in his humanity, which he received from the Virgin Mary in a way very similar to how each of us received our humanity, and because the divine nature of Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary on Christmas Day and wrapped in swaddling cloths and settled in a manger, because the divine nature of Jesus is contained in a humanity exactly the same as yours, it is possible by the grace of God. It is possible for the humanity of each one of you to be transfigured. It is possible for our humanity to be transfigured so as to contain and manifest, so as to share and participate in the divine nature of Jesus. It is possible for each one of us to actually be the divine source, are the divine sons and daughters of God. This is what St. Paul is getting at in his discourse on love, which was read to us 4 Sundays ago. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, if you care to refresh your memory from the Bible in your book rack. 4 Sundays ago, on January 30th, we heard St. Paul's discourse on love. He begins by saying in chapter 12 that you are the body of Christ and individually organic members of that body. This is because a magnificent thing has happened to you. By the mercy and love of your Heavenly Father, and by the grace of the Holy Spirit, you have been baptized, reborn into the life of Christ Jesus. And so when Paul tells us that love is patient and not jealous, or boastful, or arrogant, or rude, or irritable, that love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things, he is not saying that we must get up in the morning and decide, well, today because I love my wife, today because I love my husband, today because I love my kids, I will be patient and not irritable. Oh no. Paul is saying that the nature of our Lord and Savior is love, and that we must rise each morning and pray just as we pray when the gospel is announced at the Eucharist. Lord Jesus, be in my head and upon my lips and in my heart. Love is not something a Christian does. Love is what a Christian is, because that is what the divine nature is. And our humanity is being transfigured into the likeness of the Son of God, whom we have received at baptism, and whom we receive at God's altar week by week. But if all that I have said is true, and why does it sound so improbable? Why is it easier to think that St. Margaret is a fraud and that you're a stinker? Why is it easier than to believe that you're both Margaret and you are saints? Well, that's why I've told you about my volunteer friend and warned you about the way you've been trained to think. Jesus has said, whoever would save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake, they will be transfigured. On Wednesday, the season of Lent will overshadow us like a cloud, and we will begin the wonderful work of intentionally rethinking our lives so that we might capture Jesus, so that we might receive the Son, so that our humanity can be transfigured into the dazzling brightness of God's love, of love which is patient and kind and not jealous or boastful or arrogant or rude or irritable, a love that bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. In Christ Jesus, our Savior and Lord. The work of Lent is for the church, for you and me. The work of Lent is to not be afraid to listen to Jesus, to not be afraid to appropriate the truth, to receive Him, so that He and we might manifest the Father's doxa, might manifest heaven's glory. Amen. Let us confess in our faith in Christ's desire to transfigure our lives, saying together the Nicene Creed, out of the Baptist.
Through God, 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 through God
nations, the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others, to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, and spirit, especially Vinny, Macy, and Josh, Tom and Joanna, Sonia and Mike, Richard and Mary, Mary and Nancy, Margie and JP, John, Lorraine, and Chuck, Jim and Marie, Emmanuel and Lucy, Deborah and James, Bob and Fran, Bill and Debbie, Andy and Liz, the Halpern family, Aiden, Alex, Audrey, Colby, Cynthia, Dan, Diane, Drew, Florence, Father Jim, Gavin, Jamie, Jane, Jennifer, Jeremy, Joe, John, Johnny, Catherine, Larry, Lori, Margaret, Marie, Mark, Michael, Mike, Rachel, Robert, Sally, Scott, Shirley, Sophia, Ted, Vita, that they may be delivered from their distress. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all of God, especially Richard Duda and Margaret Callender, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for all who are celebrating birthdays this week, especially Casey Matthews, and for those observing wedding anniversaries. Lord, in your prayer,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those serving in the armed forces and their families, especially Jason Thompson, David Marcinski, Mark Hitchman, Tyler Lewis, Paul Workman, Deborah Hoyt, CJ Hoyt, Anthony Wurst, Patrick Remlett, Jessica Ramirez, and Miles. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, who art a strong tower to all who put their trust in you, be now and evermore the defense of the people of Ukraine. Grant them victory if it be thy will. Cause combatants to be merciful to the wounded and humane with their prisoners. Cheer the anxious, comfort the bereaved, succor the dying. Have mercy on the fallen. Turn the heart of Mr. Putin to, O Lord, that he may repent of his villainy and withdraw his military from Ukraine. And hasten the time, O Lord, when war shall cease in all the world. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin against God. Amen. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you, God, Father, Word, and Deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves.
We
God, have mercy on. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
Son acceptable to him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto Christ. And bring us to that heavenly country, wherewith blessed Bartholomew and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As now as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Christ,
we
are
all
your
friends.
Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now to the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. In Christ our Lord. Amen.
May Christ, the Son of the living God, be manifest in you, that your lives may be a light to the world. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you.
Thank you. Thank you for promotion and your words come true. Thank you. Nice of you.